Hi, I'm Rod Anderson, and I'm glad you're back with me again as we continue this series of studies, these 25 Bible studies called the Orchard Faith of Jesus Study. Now, you may have accidentally come onto this video now and just thinking to yourself, yeah, I'd like to actually have a look at these study guides. I'd like to learn more about the Bible. Well, there are 25 in the full set, and all you need to do is send me an email to info@theorchardmelbourne.org.au. That's info@theorchardmelbourne.org.au, and we will send these study guides out to you wherever you live in the world. They're absolutely free of charge, and we're happy for you to have them. And then you can go through these studies on the home Bible tutor, as others are doing, many people are doing at the present time, and enjoy a deeper understanding into God's Word. Now, our study today, study number 13, is called What the Bible Teaches About the Holy Law of God. And you're going to enjoy this study. You're going to be surprised from this study that we do today. Now, as is our custom, we want to ask for the blessing of God to be upon us. So let's close our eyes. We'll ask God to bless us in prayer. Father in heaven, now as we come to you, we pray that you will guide us, bless us, and illuminate us as we open your word, the Bible. I pray for those people, they may be on public transport, in public parks, they may be in office places at this present time, they may even be home in their office or in their lounge room. I just ask that you be with them, that they would sense your closeness and your love for them, Father. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Well, our subheading here is called The Importance of God's Holy Law. Question number one, how did God remind the Jews of his law after they left Egypt? So how did God remind the Jews? And when we're saying remind here, it's obviously something that had been forgotten. And in fact, when you study the earlier chapters of the Bible, Genesis and also the earlier chapters of Exodus, you actually see, in fact, that all of God's commandments, all of God's law was active and in place and enforceable for hundreds, if not thousands of years, in fact, thousands of years before we get to this event here at the Exodus. But anyway, the importance of God's holy law. Question number one, how did God remind the Jews of his law after they left Egypt? Let's turn to Deuteronomy. Now, in the Bible, we have Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So it's the fifth book of the Bible, and we're going to turn to chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verses 12 and 13 are the texts that we're looking at here. As soon as I get to it, Deuteronomy 4, verses 12 and 13. All right, here, Moses records. Remember, the book of Deuteronomy was written around 1450 BC, 1450 years before the time of Christ, at the time when Moses lived. And Moses was the writer of the book of Deuteronomy, and it says this in verses 12 and 13 of chapter 4. It says, "And the Lord spoke to you out of the midst of the fire. You heard the sound of the words, but saw no form. You only heard a voice. So he declared to you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, the Ten Commandments, and he wrote them on two tablets of stone." So how did God remind the Jews of his law after they left Israel? He gave them the Ten Commandments and he wrote them on tables of stone. That's our first answer there. Remember, as you're writing this answer down too, you can press pause at any time if you need more time to look up a verse or if you need more time to write your answers down. And we're always studying from the New King James Version Bible. There'll be times when we actually refer to the King James Version. And the reason I do that, and they are my favourite translations, is because they are not tainted with the biases of other denominations who change things and who have in the past altered things. For example, the Jehovah's Witnesses with their New World Translation. It's a corrupted form of the Bible that they've used to propound some of their false teachings. Anyway, let's continue on now. We're looking at the second question, and it says, the Ten Commandments focus on both God and man. Please explain. So the Ten Commandments focus on both God and man. Now, as I've said before, when I'm in a normal Bible study situation, when I'm in somebody's home or when I'm in a group setting, we share the reading. But I'm the only one who's going to be able to do the reading because I can't hear you. You can only hear me, obviously. So I'm going to try and make this as interesting and as engaging as possible as I read. I hope I don't become too monotone, but please forgive me if I do. But we're going to look at the differences in God's law. Now, when we study the Ten Commandments, we see actually that the first four commandments deal with our relationship with God, and the last six commandments deal with our relationship with those around us. So the first four commandments deal with our vertical relationship, and the last six commandments deal with our horizontal relationships. And what we see in all this is that in the first four commandments, we are given strategies, we're shown how to protect, prioritize and preserve our relationship with God. And in the last six commandments, we're shown how to protect and prioritize and preserve relations with other people around us, within the family and outside the family, for the better health of society. Well, let's have a look now. And I think you'll get the point that the question is making here. So we're turning to Exodus chapter 20. Now, Exodus is the second book of the Bible, Exodus chapter 20. And we're going to commence reading from verse 1, Exodus chapter 20, now, and verse 1. And here, the Israelites have left Egypt, and they've been out of Egypt for around about 45 days, a month and a half. They've come to Mount Sinai, and God speaks to them from the top of the mount, and it says this, "And God spoke all these words, saying," in verse 2, "I'm the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me." So here we have the first commandment. You shall have no other gods before me, because God wants to protect and prioritize his relationship with his people. And he doesn't want people to be deceived by believing that a man-made God is something that's going to give them eternal life and happiness, because it just doesn't. The same applies with the materialistic things of this world today. You know, there are people who serve these things, who give their heart and souls to achieve these things and to get these things, but it doesn't bring lasting happiness. Only God, who is the giver of every good and perfect gift, undergirds a sense of happiness and purpose in this life. And therefore, the things that we do achieve in our life have a better purpose, a better sense of fulfillment when God's part of that whole process. Let's have a look at the second commandment. It says, "You shall not make for yourself a carved image of any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me." And I went to great lengths and great pains to explain this verse in an earlier study. It just escapes from which study it was, but we certainly did look at it. However, this area about God visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation, and that's just in relation to what we've understand about behavioural science today and the way the role and the modelling of parenting is actually adopted and embraced by children, and the result being that the bad habits, the challenges and the failings and the weaknesses are often continued on in the next generation unless it's actually corrected at some time or at some place. But then it says, in verse 6, "But showing mercy to thousands who love me and keep my commandments." Now, is that good news? That's very good news. But it says, don't bow down to images and idols. Don't make things with your own hands and say that that's your God and you're going to serve that. This is what God's saying here. Let's look at the next commandment. The third commandment in verse 7 says, "You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain." So often when people think of this third commandment, they say, well, we shouldn't use God's name as a swear word or as a slang word, and that's very true. Because the Bible says here, for those people who do that and practice that, God will not hold them guiltless. But it's more than that. It's talking about people who claim the good name of Christ, those who claim to be followers of God, those who claim to be Christians, that if they do claim to be Christians, then they have to live a life that reflects those values. Otherwise, they are taking God's name in vain, if that makes sense. There's an old saying, practice what you preach. If you're a Christian, then in your private life and in your public life, act and behave in accordance with those beliefs. Otherwise, you are taking God's name in vain, and you are causing shame and contempt to be heaped upon God's name when you don't reflect God properly and in an orderly and obedient fashion. Let's continue on now. The fourth commandment begins with the word remember the Sabbath day, because God knew that people would forget about his Sabbath day, the day we call Saturday today. It says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall do no work, you, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens, the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. The question is asked, why should a person remember the Sabbath day? Because it's the memorial of God's creative act. That's why we do it. So these first four commandments that we've read deal with our vertical relationship. They help us to prioritize and protect and preserve our relationship with God. But the last six help us to protect, prioritize, and preserve our relationships with other people around us. On the horizontal plane, notice this, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land that the Lord your God has given you. In other words, God values the family unit, and he wants children to respect parents. But as I say to parents, parents, you must be worthy of that respect. So it's not one-way traffic here. To receive worthiness or to be receive honour, you need to be honourable people in your dealings with your children. Verse 13, you shall not murder. God values human life. Verse 14, the next commandment, you shall not commit adultery. God's law protects and prioritises the institution of marriage. Verse 15, or this is the eighth commandment, you shall not steal. God values human ownership. The ninth commandment, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbour. In other words, we cannot tell lies, we cannot gossip, we cannot stretch the truth. And how often does that happen? And nothing destroys relationships more than break of trust. And God is saying here, don't do it. Don't gossip about people. Don't bear false witness. Don't exaggerate the facts to make a story sound more palatable to other people. Don't do it, because God wants us to protect the relationships of those people that we are in at the current time. And then the 10th commandment says, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, nor his male servant, nor his female servant, nor his ox, nor his donkey, nor anything that is your neighbor's. Now, the word covet there simply means to want which belongs to somebody else, to want something that belongs to another person. And every sin begins in the mind, and coveting begins in the mind. So every other sin that we read about here, or every other breaking of any other commandment in the previous nine, it all begins with the mind. And so God says here, be careful what you think. Be satisfied with such things as you have. Now, as we think about these 10 commandments, we see that there is nobody in the entire universe more committed to healthy and happy relationships more than God. He begins by prioritizing and protecting and preserving our relationship with him, and it continues on and showing us how we can do likewise with people around us. Now, how are you possibly going to write those details in those two lines there? Not a lot of space, but this is how you do it. The first four commandments deal with our relationship with God, and the last six commandments deal with our relationship with others around us. That's how you would answer that. Question 3. Remember to press pause whenever you need to write down the text or to find the to write down the answer or find the verse under question. Why does society and individuals need the Ten Commandments? So why does society and individuals need them? Let's turn to Ecclesiastes. Now remember, Ecclesiastes is after the book of Psalms and it's after the book of Proverbs, and we're going to Ecclesiastes chapter 12 and we're looking at verses 13 and 14 now as we answer question number 3. So Exodus chapter 12, sorry, not Exodus. We've got Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Now I've just gone a little bit far in my enthusiasm here. So Ecclesiastes chapter 12. And we're looking now at verses 13 and 14. Okay, here we are. It says in verse 13 and 14, "Let us hear the whole conclusion of the matter," says King Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, who made an incredible amount of bad decisions. But in reflection, he says this. This is the most important thing in life, basically. Fear God. Remember, the word fear just means to revere. Fear God and keep his commandments. What commandments are they? Well, it's obviously the Ten Commandments. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. So why is it important that men and women keep the Ten Commandments? Because it is going to be the basis of judgment, and it points out the duty of every man and woman upon planet Earth today. All right, let's continue on. Question 4, describe the change that God's law can make in a person's life. Let's go to the book of Psalms now. Psalms mostly, largely, was written by King David, but we're going to Psalms chapter 19 and verse 7 and 8 now. Psalm chapter 19 and verses 7 and 8. So what are the changes that one could expect when they embrace and live by the Ten Commandments? Well, we read this. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Let's continue on. It says, the fear of the Lord, or reverencing the Lord, is clear, enduring forever, and the judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. Now, I want to go back to verse 7 here, which I did overlook. It says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. So what does it say for us here? We are told that men and women can be converted, that the bad character traits can be corrected as we spend time in the Word of God and as we respond to the Ten Commandments. Plus, it also says here, it makes a person wise as well. It makes us prudent. It gives us wisdom in order that we can deal with the challenges of life that confront us from day to day, week to week, year to year, throughout our lifetime. All right, the next subheading is called The Blessings of the Ten Commandments. And question 5 asks, what is the connection between God's character and God's law? Well, let's read about it now. What is the connection between God's character and God's law? Let's go to Exodus chapter 34 and verse 6. Exodus chapter 34 and verse 6. Exodus 34 and verse 6. And we have this. And the Lord passed before him. Now, the hymn here is referring to Moses. And it says, and the Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abounding in goodness and in truth. It says here that the Lord God is merciful, abounding in goodness and in truth. What's the connection between God's law? The Bible identifies God as holy. And what we're going to see now is that the Ten Commandments are identified as just, holy and good. Let's go to the book of Romans. We're going into the New Testament now as we continue our study. So we have Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, Acts and Romans. So Romans chapter 7 and verse 12. Romans chapter 7 and verse 12. And it says this. These are the words of the Apostle Paul. He says, therefore, the law, that is the Ten Commandments, is holy, and the commandment holy, just and good. Isn't it interesting? The way we identify God's law is the way that we identify God himself. So the Ten Commandments, God's law, are actually a reflection of God's character himself. That's our answer there. What is the connection between God's character and God's law? The law reflects God's character. And we've discovered already that there is nobody committed to happy and healthy relationships more than God. Let's move to question number 6 now. How is God's will and God's law connected? This is a good question. How is God's will and God's law connected? Let's go now to Psalms chapter 40 and verse 8, right in the middle of our Bible again, Psalm chapter 40 and verse 8. We're reading the words of King David, Psalm chapter 40 and verse 8, which was written around 1050 to 1025 BC, somewhere in that vicinity there. And we're going to Psalm chapter 40 and verse 8. David says, I delight to do your will, O my God, and your law is within my heart. Now, the King James Version says, I delight to do thy will, O my God, and thy law is within my heart. So what's the connection between will and law, or what's the connection between God's law and God's will? Well, what we see when David says here, I delight to do thy will, O my God, for thy law is within my heart, instead of the Ten Commandments being something that we read about on a wall or that we read in the Bible, God actually intends that the Ten Commandments are to convert us. They're actually to change us. And so when we are expressing the Ten Commandments, in other words, when we are living out the Ten Commandments in our lives, this is exactly what God wants for us. But it's not something that we do as an add-on. It's actually what we become. It's who we are as we continue our study of the Bible, as we reflect on heavenly themes, as we look at the character of God, as we think about what Jesus has done for us, as we respond to the Holy Spirit on our conscience, what happens? Our will, our character change. So instead of doing the Ten Commandments, we're living out the Ten Commandments because they become innate within us. They become a part of us. So there's our answer there. Let's move on now to page 2. And the question is asking, or the subheading begins, the Ten Commandments will continue for eternity. Question 7. What did Jesus state as the condition for eternal life? Why? Well, let's turn to the book of Matthew now. What did Jesus state as the condition for eternal life? We're looking at Matthew chapter 19 and verses 16 to 19. I want to give you a bit of a background here. Because the Bible talks about a very rich, a very prosperous young man, and perhaps it was due to inheritance, we just don't know. But he comes to Jesus and he asks him a question, and the answer that he's given is not the answer that he's actually expecting. Notice what it says here, verse 16, chapter 19, verse 16. Now behold, one came and said to him, good teacher, what must I do to have eternal life? So he said to him, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. But if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. Now let's pause here for a moment. Because when the young man comes to Jesus, he says, good master, what should I do to have eternal life? And Jesus says, well, there's nobody good but God. Now, did Jesus say, well, I'm not good? He didn't say that. But what he was reminding this young man of, that Jesus was not just a rabbi. He was more than a rabbi. He's actually God in the flesh. And that's why he answered him initially in that way. There is none good but God. He doesn't say that he's not good, nor does he say that he's not God in the flesh, but he wants to bring a point to the attention of not only the rich young ruler, but also of these hearers there at the time. So, he says, why do you call me good? He says in verse 6, if you want to enter into life, keep the commandments. And so the young man says, and he said to him, which ones? And Jesus said, you shall not murder, you should not commit adultery, you should not steal, you should not bear false witness on your mother and your father, and you shall love your neighbour as yourself. So where is Jesus quoting from here? He's quoting from the Ten Commandments. So here in the New Testament, we see a person come to Jesus, and Jesus says, if you want eternal life, keep the Ten Commandments. Now, there are some teachers, there are some churches, in fact, there are entire denominations today who say that the Ten Commandments finished at the cross. They're old hat. We don't worry about them anymore. We've got new philosophies. We've got new strategies to deal with life's complexities and to gain the favour of God. But the reality is that if Jesus had answered the question with that in mind, Jesus would have said something like this. Now, this is what you're to do. You're to keep the Ten Commandments, but as soon as you discover or hear that I'm dead, I've died on the cross, then forget about it. You don't have to worry about the Ten Commandments. You don't have to worry about murdering. You don't have to worry about adultery. You don't have to worry about bowing down to images and idols anymore because the Ten Commandments are finished at the cross. Jesus didn't say that. He says to the man, as he says to us, if you want eternal life, keep the Ten Commandments. Commandments, and he quotes from the Ten Commandments there. As we read on in this passage, we won't do it now, but if we were to read on, the young man says, all these things I've done since my childhood. And then Jesus looks at him, he loves him, and the Bible says that Jesus then identifies the pet sin, his darling sin, which was covetousness. He says, therefore, sell what you have, give to the poor, and follow me. And the Bible says that the young man went away very sad. There were certain things that he was doing, but his pet sin, his darling sin, the thing that he couldn't let go of at that point in time at least, was covetousness. He loved the praise, he loved the acclaim that came with wealth. Anyway, let's continue on now. Question number 8, it asks the question, what was Jesus' attitude towards the Ten Commandments? Now, as I've said before, press pause any time so you have time to write your answers or to look up the text. So we're going to John now, Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. John chapter 15 and verse 10. John chapter 15 and verse 10. All right, here we are. Jesus says this. He says, if you love me, keep my commandments. You will abide in my love just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. So, what was Jesus' attitude towards the Ten Commandments? Well, he believed they should be kept. Now, Jesus says here, if you love me, keep my commandments, just as I've kept my Father's commandments. So, the commandments that Jesus kept were his Father's commandments. What commandments were they? Well, they were the Ten Commandments. So if Jesus is keeping the Ten Commandments, what were Jesus' commandments and what were the commandments that Jesus wants us to keep? Well, logically, any reasonable person would come to the same conclusion that he has to be talking about the Ten Commandments themselves. Let's go on now to question number 9. Why can't we pick and choose the commandments we will obey? Well, let's go to question number 9 now. This is question number 9, but we're going back to Matthew chapter 5 and verse 17 and 18. Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 and 18. And we're going to read this, Matthew 5, verse 17 and 18. And here, Jesus says, Do not think that I've come to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. You see, this was a charge that Jesus came to remove the law. He's come to undermine the authority of the prophets. Jesus says, I haven't come to do any of those things. He says, I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. In other words, Jesus came to live out. So let's think about this. Jesus first talks about the law here, the Ten Commandments. He says, I didn't come to destroy it, I've come to live it out. And we know that Jesus was without sin. We already know that sin is the transgression of the law, the breaking of the Ten Commandments. So Jesus lived a perfect life without any sin. In other words, he didn't break the Ten Commandments. He came to live out the Ten Commandments in order that he could be a propitiation for our sins. He could be an atonement for our sins. He had to live the perfect life that we couldn't live because of our fallenness. Jesus did it in our stead. But it also says here, he didn't come to destroy the law and the prophets. He came to fulfill them. So how did Jesus fulfill the prophets? Well, all of the hundreds of prophecies that we see written of the Messiah, starting with Genesis chapter 3, we see the prophecy there, then other prophecies in the book of Genesis continue and in Exodus and elsewhere. There are hundreds of prophecies which pointed to the Messiah to come. Jesus says, I haven't come to destroy them, I've come to live them out so that you can see that I am the one. I am God with us. I am Emmanuel. I was the one born of a virgin. I was the one born in Bethlehem, etc., etc., etc. Then he says here in chapter 5, verse 17 and 18, he says, for assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. What is Jesus saying here? Not one jot, nor one tittle. Now, as we reflect on those words there, and going back to my Hebrew at university, the yod is the smallest letter in the Hebrew alphabet, and the tittle is just like the dotting of the I or the crossing of the T. So Jesus is saying, not even the smallest letter in the law is going to be removed. Not even the tiniest dot or the crossing of the T is going to be removed from God's law till heaven and earth pass away. Now, Jesus is challenging you. If anybody says to you, if your pastor, if your minister, if your reverend, if your priest says to you, we don't worry about the Ten Commandments anymore, they're old hat, then all you have to do to test the veracity of their statement is to go outside, and if you can still see the sky and if you can kick the earth, then you know that God's law, the Ten Commandments, are still in place. Does that make sense? It's fairly simple. It's so simple, you know, that even a child can understand this. Let's continue on because we're asked to look at different... we're looking at James now. James chapter 2, as we're answering question 9, which asks, why can't we pick and choose the commandments that we will obey? Well, because Jesus says the law is in place. Not even a jot, not even a tittle can be removed from it. So we can't pick and choose the commandments we want to obey. But let's find out more about this, because as we go to the book of James. Now, James is becoming quite a familiar book to you. We've been here a number of times. It's straight after Hebrews. It's before the book of Revelation. It's before 1 and 2 Peter. And remember, James was the brother of Jesus, the younger brother of Jesus. So we're going to James, and we're looking at James chapter 2, verses 8 to 13. And here we read this. If you fulfill the royal law. Now, it's interesting as we read what James says about the Ten Commandments. He identifies the Ten Commandments in two ways. He identifies it as the royal law, and he identifies it as the law of liberty. He says, if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You do well. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever shall keep the whole law and yet stumble in one point, he is guilty of all. Now, James says here, If you keep all the Ten Commandments, but you choose to ignore one, then you're guilty of breaking them all. But then somebody might say, well, how do we know what commandments he's referring to? Well, verse 11, he says, For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not commit murder. Now, where is he quoting from? James is quoting from the Ten Commandments. It's very clear. Now, if you do not commit adultery, but you do murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and so do as those who will be judged by the law of liberty. Why can't we pick and choose what commandments we keep? Because God has told us that we cannot, that if we break one commandment, we break all of them. If we ignore one commandment, we're ignoring all of them in God's sight. The reason is they are the foundation. They are going to be the basis upon which every man, woman is going to be judged at the time of the judgment. All right, let's continue on now. And we're looking at question number 10, and it says, who assists us as we endeavour to keep God's law? So we're going to go to John chapter 14, the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark and Luke and John. So who assists us as we endeavour to keep God's law? John chapter 14 and verses 15 to 17, and we read this. Jesus is speaking about the Holy Spirit here, and he says, if you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper. Who's the helper? Well, we know in verse 26 of this same chapter, it's referring to the Holy Spirit. And then it says, and he will give you another helper that he may abide with you forever. So Jesus was the first helper, and Jesus is praying for another helper to assist men and women in their walk with God. And that other helper, or the comforter, as the King James Version says, is the Holy Spirit. And it says, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither knows him nor sees him, but you know him, because for he dwells with you and will be in you. Now that's what I call help. Not only does he teach us, instruct us, convict us, but the Holy Spirit is also within us to help us do the right thing and to live according to the Ten Commandments. Let's look at this a little further now in the answer to question number 10, because we're going to Romans chapter 8 and verses 3 and 4, and we read this. This is from the Apostle Paul. It says, for what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, that is, because we have fallen natures, because we live in a fallen world, etc., etc. You know, we cannot keep the law of God unaided. Notice this. For what the law could not do that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. On account of sin, he condemned sin in the flesh. So we couldn't do it, but Jesus came to this world, and even though he had a fallen nature like us, he kept the Ten Commandments perfectly. And then it says that the righteous requirements of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Now, it works both ways here, or two ways, I should say. As we cooperate with the promptings of the Holy Spirit, it doesn't mean that we're perfect. It doesn't mean that we're ideal. It doesn't mean that we are faultless. But as we cooperate with the Holy Spirit, and because of our faith in Jesus Christ and having accepted his meritorious act on the cross for on our behalf, it means that we are accounted righteous. The just requirements of the law are fulfilled in us because of what Jesus has done and because we are responding to the holy influence of the Spirit in our lives. All right, let's move on now. Remember to press pause if you need time to write your answers. But who assists us as we endeavour to keep the Ten Commandments? It's the Holy Spirit. He helps us. Question 11. How are God's people described as they prepare for the second coming of Christ? So how are God's people in the last days described as they prepare for the second coming of Jesus Christ? Well, let's go to the book of Revelation. easy to find. The last book in the Bible. And we're going to Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12 now. And we read this. Revelation 14 and verse 12. John says, here is the patience of the saints. I should pause here. Actually, this is the angel who was telling John, and this is what John has seen. This is what he's hearing as well. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the what? The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. In this passage, Revelation chapter 14, verse 12, the last book of the Bible, it tells us here is the patience of the saints. So God's people need patience. Then it says, they keep the commandments of God. What commandments are they? Well, they are the Ten Commandments, but also notice, and have the faith of Jesus. What this means is, these people in the last days do not believe that they're saved by keeping the law. They do not believe by salvation by works. They don't believe that at all. They believe that they are saved because of their faith in Jesus Christ. In other words, they understand they're saved by grace. That what Jesus was able to achieve for them on the cross, and when they accept Jesus as their Lord and Saviour, the merits of Christ's crucifixion and what he achieved on behalf of mankind are accredited to him, and therefore they are saved by grace. It's not what they've done, it's all about Jesus. So what do they do as a loving response? Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Jesus says, keep my Father's commandments as I've kept my Father's commandments. Jesus, in this text here that we're reading, John says in Revelation 14, verse 12, he says that God's people, though they keep the commandments of God, they understand that their salvation is dependent upon Jesus Christ. Yet they keep the Ten Commandments not in order to be saved, but because they are saved. It's their loving response to what Jesus has done for them. So this is our answer here. How are God's people described as they prepare for Christ's second coming? As those who keep the commandments of God and have faith in Jesus Christ for their salvation. Question number 12, the last question. Who are able to enter the city of God? The city of God in the Bible is identified as the New Jerusalem. The Bible talks about heaven and paradise and the New Jerusalem. These sort of things are fairly synonymous throughout the Bible. But who are able to walk in through the city gates into the New Jerusalem? Well, let's stay in Revelation and we're looking at chapter 22, the last book in the Bible, and we're reading from verse 14. And John says this, blessed are those who do his commandments. Now, what does it mean to do his commandments? It means to live out God's commandments. So there's a blessing to those who keep God's commandments, who do God's commandments, that they might have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. It's clear, isn't it? God expects everybody to keep the Ten Commandments, and God expects people in the last days after the cross to keep the Ten Commandments as well. And then God judges the righteous based on their response to the light they've been given, but also having understood the importance of the Ten Commandments. Have they accepted it or have they rejected it? That's the question. All right. Summarize the reasons why we should keep the Ten Commandments. So go back over your answers, look up some verses if you need to, and summarize why we should keep the Ten Commandments. Moving to the reflection question now. What is our motivation for being faithful to the Ten Commandments? Well, some people may say because it will help and assist us in the salvation process, and that is very true. But the reason any of us should keep the Ten Commandments is because we love Jesus. That's the reason. He's asked us to do it. And our loving response is because we love Jesus. question two of the reflection section. Remember, in this reflection section, we understand what the Bible has said on this topic, and now we're asking, how does it apply? Or this section asks, how does it apply to me in the life that I live, in the world in which I find myself today? Then question two, how will honoring the Ten Commandments help our interpersonal relationships? Well, again, go back over your answers that you've already read, but what we've seen is that God helps us to protect and prioritize our relationships with people that we come in contact with. All right, now we go to the resolution. My resolution, I determine to show my appreciation of God's love for me by accepting all Ten Commandments from this point in time on. So if you're happy with that, if you understand the importance of the Ten Commandments and you want to be faithful to them as a loving response to what Jesus has done, then write your name and sign your name beside it. All right. Now we're on to the additional study section. This is where we put a little bit more substance into the study. And we're starting reading from the subheading, which says the importance of the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments were written by God on two tablets of stone given to Moses at Mount Sinai around 1450 BC. They were written in stone, not on sand, not on papyrus, but stone to reinforce their perpetuity. God intended that the Ten Commandments were to be lived out by every man, woman, and child on earth and to be the governing principles that would shape every nation's civil laws. The Ten Commandments are for all mankind. The Ten Commandments were not given to Moses and the Jews at Mount Sinai exclusively for the benefit of the Hebrews. God honored them by making them the guardians and the keepers of his law, but he intended that it should be held by them as a sacred trust for the whole world. The Ten Commandments are to be embraced by all mankind, and they were given for the instruction and government of all. They show us our duty to God and also our duty to others around us. The Ten Commandments are spiritual. Just as God is described as spirit, so also are the Ten Commandments. They are the standard of truth and the discerner of error. The law is a copy of God's character. Both are holy, both are just and perfect and eternal. God is described as eternal. His law is also eternal. Perpetuity of God's law. Christ did not change the law, but he confirmed and kept the Ten Commandments. The prophets of old and Jesus' disciples after Christ's resurrection also kept the Ten Commandments. John in vision sees the righteous enter the eternal city, who are described as those who do God's commandments. The next subheading is Christ's law is fundamental for happy life. Christians live happy, full lives when they are obedient to God's requirements. God's law helps us cope with the ups and downs of life. It proves we truly love God when we do as he has commanded. Furthermore, the redeemed will keep God's law because it is a reflection of God's character. God empowers us to keep the holy law with the abiding presence through the abiding presence of the Holy Spirit. Blessings that we receive by keeping God's commandments. The universe, God's creation, is governed by natural laws. In addition, God instituted moral and spiritual laws for our spiritual well-being. They are like the wise instruction a father gives a child to guide it in its development. The biblical instruction is clear regarding the authority of the Ten Commandments, and in keeping them, we will be blessed. Law and grace. No one is saved by keeping the Ten Commandments. We are saved by grace due to our faith in Jesus Christ. However, the law has an essential role in the salvation process. For example, it tells us what sin is. The Ten Commandments are described as a mirror, so we see ourselves as God sees us, and then we confess our sins before the foot of the cross where we are fully forgiven. Grace and faith do not invalidate the law of God. Our desire to be obedient to God, now I've gone to the top of the column here, So I hope I've gone from here to here. I hope you're not confused. Grace and faith do not invalidate the law of God. Our desire to be obedient to God's commandments reflect our willingness to please God because of what Jesus has done for us on the cross. The law of God has not been abolished. Jesus taught clearly that the law of God does not change and did not finish at the cross. However, there is a difference between God's moral law, the Ten Commandments, which is eternal, and the ceremonial laws which dealt with priestly ceremonies and functions of the Jewish temple system, which ended with Jesus' sacrificial death on the cross. Notice the clear difference between the moral law and the ceremonial law. Now, I'm going to read from the chart here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to refer to the moral law and then the ceremonial law. And I'm going to go line by line through this table so that you can see there is a clear difference between God's moral eternal law and the ceremonial law that was for a specific time and place and people. All right, Ten Commandments, laws of ethics and morality towards our God and those around us, compared to the ceremonial laws, which were laws referring to the ceremonial system and the priestly functions. All right, here we go. One, the Ten Commandments is spiritual. The ceremonial law is of the flesh. The Ten Commandments are known as the royal law. The ceremonial law is known as the ritual law. The Ten Commandments were given by God. The ceremonial law in the second column were given by Moses. The Ten Commandments were written in stone, and the ceremonial law was written in a book by Moses. The Ten Commandments are unchangeable. The ceremonial law was temporal. The Ten Commandments was not abolished at the time of the cross, and the ceremonial was abolished at the time of the cross because Jesus was the shadow of things to come. Jesus was the Lamb of God, the sacrifice for mankind. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, the moral law contained in the Ten Commandments and enforced by the prophets, he, Jesus, did not take away. It was not the design of his coming to revoke any part of this. Every part of this law must remain in force upon all mankind and in all ages. Final thought. One Christian writer has written, obedience is not a mere outward compliance, but the service of love. If our hearts are renewed in the likeness of God, if the divine love is implanted in the soul, will not the law of God be carried out in the life? When the principle of love is implanted in the heart, when man is renewed after the image of him that created him, the new covenant promise is fulfilled. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And if the law is written in the heart, will it not shape the life? Obedience, the service and allegiance of love is the true sign of discipleship. Well, that's quite a study. And I hope now that you actually see the Ten Commandments in an entirely different light, because then it's not just about thou shalt not. It's about God wanting to protect our relationships, not only with him, but with those around us as well. Well, our time has come to a close now. Next week, we're going to be doing, or the next time that you're with me on this format, we're going to be doing study number 14, and it is what the Bible teaches about the Sabbath. Now, don't shy away from this. This is a very important study. So in order for you to be able to make good decisions, you need to have all the facts. And remember this, the truth has nothing to fear from investigation. So it can be scrutinized, it can be cross-examined. And that's exactly what we're going to do next week as we study the subject of the Sabbath as we find it in the fourth commandment of God's Ten Commandments. Well, that's all we have time for now. Now we commence with prayer. Why don't we close with prayer as well? Father, we do thank you that you've been so good and merciful to us. and we've understanding more of your will and what you desire from us. And we see that the Ten Commandments are not a burden. They're not a drudgery, but you've given them to us so that we would have freedom, that we would have liberty, that we wouldn't be under the yoke or under the burden of a terrible guilty conscience, that we would have liberty, that we would have freedom as we respond to you. And we want to thank you for that, Father. And we thank you, Father, now that we all realize very clearly that you are the God who wants to protect relationships, not only with yourself and us, but also so that we can protect relationships with others around us on the horizontal plane. So we thank you, Father, and all praise and all honor to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we thank you. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, thank you for being with me. And as I said earlier, the truth is nothing to fear from investigation. I'm Rod Anderson, and goodbye for now.